also with incredible great pleasure that I get to introduce Howard Caygill, who's Professor of Philosophy at Kingston University, author of On Resistance and most recently On Resistance, A Philosophy of Defiance, and the forthcoming book Kafka in the Light of the Accident and Staging Disorder, and how his paper is going to be analysis of the Tate's ethics policy. I'm going to have to give you a mic for him.
Corporate ethical policies are chimerical documents, characterized above all by a lack of ethical clarity and a patent disregard for the protocols of ethical reasoning. Not ethical at all. They systematically confuse the subject and scope of ethical action, as well as departing. Tate's ethical policy, viewed in this respect, is completely unremarkable. It's systematically confused and is no way consistent with the pursuit of an ethical good, but is absolutely obsessed with the avoidance of the possibility of individual corruption. It's very important that it's individual corruption. It offers the minimal standards of corporate governance. So, the document approved by the Board of Trustees on March 19th, 2014, begins with a fundamental equivocation about the ethical subject. So, who is it or what is it that's supposed to be behaving ethically in the case of Tate? Who exactly is meant to be subject to the ethical principles laid out? The document that's organized according to an introduction, it's usually a philosophical preamble to the ethical policy, followed by a statement. also rather strange because it involves a systematic blurring of ethical responsibility in the tent. This very notion of the representative, this way of understanding the representative, will range from the trustees, from the director, to the trustees, to the employees. So according to this view of ethical subjectivity, or this view of the representative, Sarota has the same ethical responsibility as somebody who works in the bookshop. That there is no recognition of there being any special ethical considerations for the trustees, for those who govern the institution, and for those who work in the institution. All are representatives of Tate. And the document proceeds as if all these representatives are equally powerful and equally entitled ethical actors, all sharing that same proclivity for corruption. So corruption in the Tate ranges from the director to the attendants and the gatherers there. Everybody's potentially corrupt. and the ethical policy is there to ensure that everybody is controlled. But of course, the opportunity for corruption, this kind of mask, even on these terms, which I'm arguing against, but even on these terms of individual corruption, the opportunity for corruption of the director or trustee is obviously much larger than the employer of the tenant. So this idea of the representative as the ethical actor obscured more than it really is, since some representatives are more representative than others. So the Tate ethical policy then is accordingly both human relations and a policy document. So this is another peculiarity, feature of it. It's about staffing policy and about the strategic ethical aims of content. And this is clear again at the very outset of the book in the declaration that the Tate claims that its statement of ethical policy is consistent with, first, the Museum's Association's Code of Ethics for Museums. Secondly, the Code of Ethics for Museums worldwide. Thirdly, the NOLA Committee's 7 Principles of Public Life. And then, finally, and strangely, the Staff Code of Conduct. So we kind of range from the ethical considerations, philosophical considerations of modern museums, to the Staff Code of Conduct. These are the main documents for this policy. That is to say, it's a document concerned with institutional subject, the museum, and also it forms part of the disciplinary code applied to its employees. It's very interesting to go and look at the documents that that inspire the Tate ethical policy, with which the Tate ethical policy considers itself to be consistent. The Museums Association document referred to here is unusually revealing about the limits of museum ethics, and it is revealing for understanding the limits of the Tate's ethical policy. So Vanessa Trevelyan, who's the chair of the Museum Association's Ethics Committee, offers a philosophical preamble to the ethical code, disarmingly asking, quote, what is the code of ethics actually for? And she replies that it should represent and articulate a set of consensual values that are agreed at a particular time to define a relationship of trust between the museum and the community it serves. So this is the aspiration. The ethical policy is about the relationship of trust between the museum and those the community that it serves. Now this is quickly abandoned as being, which I believe you describe as, too aspirational. And even though she claims that her own document virtue of this definition, the Museums Association definition, distinguishing between the ethical subject who works for and the one who exercises governing power, that is, those who work for and those who control. So he's elided in the concept of a representative. But any advantages from this distinction are lost in the subsequent distinction. This is the ethical collapse of the Museums Association doctrine. Distinction between the aspirational and the pragmatic aspects of an ethical code. And Trevelyan, you know, winding up the philosophical preamble to the ethical code, claims, quote, "There is no point in occupying the ethical high ground if that results in museums becoming unsustainable." So this is a frequently recognizable, frequently repeated proposition to take the money and run. But it basically amounts to the betrayal of ethics and ethical reason. If ethics does not occupy the high ground, then it will be replaced by pragmatics. Which is to say, and this document, Museums Association document, claims this after 25 years of reflection, it claims that in the end, pragmatic considerations will trump ethical considerations. That the sustainability of the institution has more ethical worth than other ethical considerations. And this, of course, is also characteristic of the Tate document. The Tate document sets out principles, duty to the public, avoidance of personal gain, that are to be observed by the Tate's representatives. So ethics, again, I keep repeating this, but it's so striking. Ethics, in other words, consists in not being individually corrupt, and by definition, institution cannot be corrupted only its representatives. Now, this, I think, has important tactical considerations, particularly when opposing discrete actions or acts by the Tate. So the tactic of looking through the principles, using freedom of information kind of demands, to find out if the code has been violated by the Board of Trustees on a particular occasion. The tactic of asking whether BP sponsorship, for example, is the case under Section 4C, that is, does it significantly damage the effective operation of the Tate in delivering its mission, run the danger, those two claims run the danger of becoming complicit with ethically narrow terms of reference that the policy document makes. So in a sense, it's it'll drive any ethical judgment of the BP, shall be the sponsorship case, back to the question of whether there was individual corruption involved. Because according to this document, there would only have been an unethical act if there had been individual corruption by one of the Tate representatives. Actually, in itself, and according to this document's definition of ethics, there's nothing unethical about sponsorship. So there's something very wrong with the particular structure, both of the ethical policy and the ethical committee. And it's very, very telling that this particular clause, section 4C, which is the nearest you can get to reputational damage, has the revealing subclause that the ethical damage or otherwise is subject to the judgment of the Board of Trustees. So ultimately, according to this document, the ethical arbiters of the institution are those who govern and control. So this is definitely the pragmatic high ground. And we basically have the governance of the institution deciding on whether they have acted or not. And I think it's at this point that the role of the ethics committee becomes very until we tried at one point. We spent all that time reviewing applications from the psychology department, and we knew that there were there's work being produced in the fine art department using live animals and ordinary substances, which came under our ethical group. When we decided to send a questionnaire around the department saying, is there any work being conducted in the department that might be ethically questionable, we were told that we were under virus. Actually, the committee could not ask for that. We didn't have an investigative or proactive role. We could only receive an advice. And this is precisely the case with the text structure. So we have a very compromised ethical document with an utterly powerless ethics committee that is administered. So it might be possible, and this is again now responding to the activist critique of it might be possible to argue that the ethical policy as it stands offers very little tactical leverage for applying pressure on the text. However, the actions around the BP sponsorship might be able to develop into something more, into something different. They might be able to exceed the limits of resistance to this decision by the institution and offer the platform for the formulation and implementation of a different form of ethical policy to qualify. This would be substantive and based on a formulation of positive principles of the good to be pursued by Tate or any institution, rather than negative principles for the avoidance of corruption by its representatives. Politics, after all, not ethics, is the realm of the lesser evil. Ethics must mean more than simply offering means to avoid the evil of corruption. This is an ethical policy that should have a differentiated understanding of ethical subjectivity based on power and entitlement. It should have a set of positive ethical goals and a proactive ethics committee. It could at least aspire to this and break with the cynicism that prevails when we see in ethics. So beyond the critique of the activists of the Shell BP decision, it seems that there's a possibility to broaden that into an ethical reform of TAPE as an institution. So perhaps the actions against Shell BP could also become actions for the constitution of an ethical institution. That is, not only questioning the ethical wisdom and prudence of this,